He has about 25 years plus experience of corporate, in corporate, diverse sectors like engineering, textiles, apparel, brands and retail, education and consulting. A postgraduate from the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai, he has a notable career. Some of his assignments include General Manager, People Officer Zone of Future Value Retail Limited, which is part of the Future Group, Director, Human Resource of Indian School of Business, Head of HR, Lifestyle Apparel Business of Arvind Limited, Senior Manager, Human Resource of Ambattur Clothing Limited. We welcome you, sir. Next, we have Mr. Narayan R. Tamaya. Mr. Tamaya is the venture partner at Axel, one of the most successful venture capital firms in the world. He is a certified business coach with a career spanning over 25 years. He has held leadership positions in organizations like Capillary Technologies, Rambus, Co-Systems, and Qualcomm Spike Technologies. And when he is not helping companies and people develop their strengths to achieve their potential, he pursues his joy in mountaineering, having summited a few peaks in the Himalayas over 6,000 meters and the Austrian Alps. He is also an avid marathoner with a passion for long distance running, especially sub-4 marathons. Thank you, sir, for joining us. And last, we have Ms. Vijayanti Marvisheri. Ms. Marvisheri has over 25 years of extensive HR experience in national as well as multinational IT and manufacturing environments. She is the Associate Director at Deva Pharma. Prior to this, she has worked as General Manager, People Strategy, Planning and Operations at Samsung Electronics, Head Organization Effectiveness at Hindustan Coca-Cola Beverages Private Limited, Senior Director, Human Resources at Biocon, Manager, Career Management at Tesco. Has worked in several other companies like Infosys Technologies Limited, McAfee Inc., Whirlpool Corporations, and Watson Wyatt India Private Limited. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us.
Thank you. I now request Professor Anant Raman, Provost, XIME Bangalore, to welcome the gathering.
Good afternoon. Welcome to an exciting afternoon of Maria Philip Memorial Intercollegiate Debating Competition. This is the 33rd year of this competition. This year we have conducted the competition in three different zones. 77 teams competed in the Kerala region, with finals held at our Kochi campus last week. About 20 teams are expected to compete in the Tamil Nadu zone, and the finals are expected to be held at Chennai campus on the 24th of October. 27 teams competed in Karnataka zone, with the finals today at this campus. All contests so far at all locations were real high-octane, high-caliber. We expect the same thing to happen here today. But I want you to look at this as something much more than just a debating competition. Because at the core of this is a story, which is the story of XIME itself. With it is a story which is both sad and inspiring. That is the story of Maria Philip. Maria Philip was somebody like you, young, bright, effervescent. She was 22, clever, talented, beautiful. Her future spread before her like a brilliant textured tapestry. Like you, she was about to graduate from a master's degree program, but a freak accident on a railway track abruptly ended her life. It's always a puzzle and a mystery why do lives, and bright lives to boot, get cut short so easily. Several reasons are advanced. Plausible, rational, biblical, ecclesiastic, logical reasons. In fact, somebody even asked the divine, why do good people die so young? And God is reported to have replied, my son, when you are in a garden, which flowers do you pick? Only the most beautiful. And this beautiful flower, Maria, had asked her dad, who was then the director of IIM, dad, why don't you build a business school? And the fond dad, Professor J. Philip, started his daughter's dream in a shed in Martha's Hospital, Bangalore, which is today the multi-campus design. And as you listen to the debate today, that is the story I want you to remember. That what Maria left behind is not what is engraved in stone monuments, but is woven into the lives of nearly 4,000 management graduates that have walked out of these portals. Very few people get to decide the legacy they leave, but Maria created a legacy that inspired her father to dream more, to learn more, to do more, and to become more. What a wonderful reversal of roles. And as you listen to these bright young minds debate here today, it is that legacy and that journey I want you to visualize. Thank you.
Some will speak for the motion for 4 minutes, and other will speak against the motion for 4 minutes. There will not be any cross rebuttal rounds. A warning bell will be rung at the end of 3 minutes, and a final bell at the end of 4 minutes. There will be a negative marking for exceeding the 4 minutes time limit. Team should not wear the college uniform, blazers indicating the name of the institution, nor mention the name of the institution during the speech. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the Maria Philip Memorial Karnataka State Intercollegiate Debate Competition shall commence now. I request all the dignitaries to take their seat at the front row and all the participants to shift to the MPP room.
Very good afternoon to one and all present here. So the topic for today is India is not yet ready for the transition to electric vehicles. Now I, being the opposition side, truly believe that India is ready and now is the perfect time for this revolutionary change. I've divided my arguments into three main parts. Firstly, India is a country that is developing at an exceptional rate. So the question to be asked is, when can India make this revolutionary change to electric vehicles? Well, in fact, India has already made this change since the year 1925 with the inception of the electric trains. Now, what can the government do to help in a smoother transition? They can bring in policies, they can bring in reforms. Well, the government of India, we're already ahead of the curve. We have the FAME II policy, which promises to bring 10,000 crores for electric vehicles, as well as 1,000 crores for the electric stations to charge these electric vehicles. There is a GST drop from 12% all the way to 5%, and even a tax incentive of 1.5 lakh for every individual who invests in an electric vehicle. Now my second argument is about the environment, which is just a huge factor in this equation. We know that petrol consumption is at an all-time high. We are using it at such a pace that in the next 50 years, we're going to be all out of it. So we know it's an undisputed fact that sooner or later, we have to make that switch toward a more renewable resource. And in this case, it can be electricity, and for transportation, e-vehicles. Now you must be thinking, where are we going to get all this electricity to charge our whole country? Well, in fact, India again is already ahead of the curve. We have a whole airport in Cochin that is being charged by solar energy. Why not take that technology and put it into our households? Panasonic, one of the leading producers of the charging stations in India, already have solar panels set up in their stations. Now let's talk about the low carbon emission. We know that petrol vehicles releases a large amount of carbon dioxide and sulfur and is destroying our environment. And electric vehicles, that's a huge 0% of carbon emissions. Now let's talk about electric vehicle companies such as the Ford Classic as well as the Nissan Leaf that are not only electric vehicles but are using plastic and non-recyclable materials to build the body of their cars, seats as well as steering wheels. You could say that you're sitting in trash but traveling in luxury. Now, I understand these electric vehicles have a lot of e-waste as well as it's hard to discharge these batteries. But when you check both parts of it, the parts about how bad petrol vehicles have destroyed the environment as well as the future of electric vehicles, I think electric vehicles gets a win in this part. Now let's talk about the third main aspect of why electric vehicles are the future. Firstly, they're just much more safer. Electric vehicles have a low center of gravity which prevents any tumbling or rolling over of the cars, which has been a huge issue in our country today. I would also like to talk about how people who invest in this are going to make their money back because of the ever-increasing price of petrol. And also, Tempo, an electric vehicle company that has invested in electric vehicles in a developing country like Nepal, has already seen a 60% rise in women entrepreneurs. This has been a huge part of their GDP. I understand countries like Sweden and Norway have already made the switch to electric vehicles, but this is after they've made a huge dent in the environment with their petrol vehicles. Now imagine a developing country like India already makes the switch to electric vehicles. We are looking at a much brighter and greener future. With these main arguments, I still believe that India is ready for this revolutionary change, and we know sooner or later we need to make the switch to electric vehicles, and that time is now. Thank you and have a wonderful day.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Today I will be speaking for the proposition, India is not yet ready for the transition to electric vehicles. Now my main argument will be divided into three points. Firstly, the failure of government policies and the lack of supporting infrastructure. Now I must admit that the Indian government has started to prepare the country for this huge change using policy changes. But how many of these policies are actually grounded in the reality of our country today? Let's look at an example. 2 years ago, Mr. Nitin Gadkari, the Transport Minister of India, set an extremely high target that by the year 2030, there would be a 100% transition to electric vehicles. However, today's report suggests that only a 40% transition is even possible. Now, the reason for the blatant failure of this goal, the elephant in the room that's begging to be discussed, is that India is still a developing, power deficit country. 200 million citizens of our country still do not have access to electricity in their homes. In the 600,000 villages of our country, even petrol-driven cars haven't reached every household. Electricity is still a far-off dream, and so electric cars seem like something out of a utopian fantasy. Now, you don't need to step into a village to understand this problem. Let's look at the developed metropolitan cities of our country. We still face long, frequent power cuts. And so the thought of owning an electric vehicle that requires 8 hours worth of charging seems like a sadistic joke. Now, what if we were to use the public charging stations? The situation does not get better. The infamous FAME 2 policy, which was set up to help the EV industry in our country, has decided to set up 4,000 charging stations across the country. Now, 4,000 may seem like a huge number, but this is just 1% of what is actually required to meet the goal by the year 2030. And even if more funds were raised to start more public charging stations, we still wouldn't have enough electricity to power them. This is a vicious cycle that India just isn't ready to break yet. Coming to the second part of my argument, will the electric vehicle industry really be as environment friendly as the government claims it will? Consider this. Today, 72% of India's electricity is being produced in coal-fired plants. These are the plants that are emitting huge amounts of carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, lead, and mercury into the very environment that this industry claims to save. Secondly, even the well-developed European Union countries of today still are able to only recycle 5% of their lithium-ion battery waste. In a situation like this, with India's current waste disposal system, it is impossible for India to dispose and recycle electric vehicle battery waste in an environment-friendly manner. This is a fact which is supported by the compliance report by the Central Pollution Control Board itself. And thus it seems like the various government agencies of our country are contradicting each other. Finally, I would like to consider the consumer's point of view. An electric vehicle is significantly more expensive than its counterpart, not just to buy, but for repairs and maintenance as well. The cost of replacing your battery could be up to 40% the cost of your car itself. Secondly, electric vehicles take up to 8 hours to charge, and if you were to choose a battery replacement model, this would hike up your price by 50%. Finally, an electric vehicle loses more charge while standing stationary than a petrol vehicle loses fuel. Now, this is a nightmare in cities like Bangalore and Mumbai, where traveling means more traffic than actual transport. I thus reiterate my stance that even though electric vehicles prove to be the future of transportation, that time has not yet arrived and India is not yet ready. Thank you.
Is ready. Do you think with the power consumption or the power shortage, power availability, do you think India is ready? And why do you think? Can you substantiate one of your arguments a little bit more elaborately?
Yes, sir. I've already explained Panasonic, the company. So they're setting up electric charging stations all over India. They're the leading electric stations makers in India. So what they've done is on top of their stations, they've set up these solar panels. So a car comes in, takes electricity, and the station itself is already recharging to the solar panel it has used. And then this way it can already start charging itself. Now even solar panel technology is brought into our cities, to the metropolitan cities. On top of every household, we have solar panels set up. And the people who use electric vehicles, once they're done with their office, they can come back and charge their cars that way itself. So with that, you can use electricity.
Do you know what percentage of houses have solar panels in India, urban cities? Do you have any data?
No, sir.
So how can you say that can be done? What percentage is solar panels? The cost of solar panels setting up in houses, do you know how expensive is it?
Yes, sir, I understand. But even electric vehicles, right?
Because you're giving that argument, you're saying that if I buy an electrical vehicle, I can come back home and then the Panasonic solar panel will help me charge my vehicle, correct?
Yes, sir. I understand it's a small percentage, but again, companies like Panasonic have already set up stations for people who can't afford solar panels in their house. They can use these stations to charge electric vehicles.
Thank you, Ben and Nadia. Good luck.
Now, what is this buzz around electric vehicles that we keep on talking about? Is it really environment friendly? Is it really convenient to the average Indian? Is it genuinely cost effective? We're about to find out. So coming to the cost of the electric vehicle. Firstly, an electric vehicle is always going to cost 1.5 to 2 times that of a normal vehicle. Let's take the Mahindra KUV as an example. The Mahindra KUV on-road costs around 6 to 10 lakhs. So if I'm to launch a base model of the electric version of a Mahindra KUV 100, it's going to be a minimum of 10 lakhs. The battery in an electric vehicle accounts to around 50% of the cost in 4-wheelers and 70% of the cost in 2-wheelers. Now coming to the environmental aspect, according to a BCG report, coal has an emission factor of 1,002 grams per kilowatt hour. 70% of electricity is produced by burning coal, so in turn, there is more pollution. I would also like to say that water has an emission factor of 13 grams per kilowatt hour, but is not being practiced in India on a large scale. Now coming to the battery of an electric vehicle is a lithium-ion battery, also commonly known as an LIB. LIBs do not support long distance travel, and the raw materials required to make LIBs are in short supply. Not to mention the fact that the auto industry is in a slowdown right now, so selling electric vehicles is going to be an issue. The government, they only tend to incentivize the fleet vehicles, that is the cabs, and they are not focusing on private ownership. Another point I would like to touch upon is range anxiety. Now, what is range anxiety? Range anxiety is basically the anxiety that a person has as to how far the car can travel in a single charge. Now, not counting any of the Tesla models, the longest recorded is the Hyundai Kona, that is 258 miles or 412 kilometers. Now, these testings are not done on actual road conditions. On an actual road condition, it would be somewhere around 125 kilometers to 200 kilometers, depending upon how you drive it. Not to mention, the charging infrastructure in India is almost non-existent. Not everyone owns a garage, so charging your car would be an issue. And also, charging an electric vehicle takes around 12 hours. So, well, a human being is not going to stand next to his vehicle for 12 hours if there's no garage. And there are a lack of models available out there today, so we've got a lot of ground to cover when it comes to that. And finally, I would like to conclude by answering two vital questions. One, is India ready for the transition to electric vehicles? No, I don't believe so. Two, will India be ready for the transition to electric vehicles? It certainly can be. Thank you.
Good afternoon, respected jury members and everyone present here. I am Zoe Balabobli. Today I am here to speak against the notion India is not yet ready to transition into electric vehicles. The shift in the EV industry today is very much needed for the automotive industry in India, not just to regain its foothold, but also to incline itself towards the global shift in access towards the EV industry. As far as the Zetron technology is concerned, which is the indigenously developed technology by Tata Motors today, it guarantees a whopping 8 years of warranty to the motor, as opposed to the traditional ICs and EVs having not more than 4 years of warranty. It has been tested on road for around 200 kilometers and is estimated to be launched in 2020. Kinkyo, which is the fifth largest producer of two-wheeler manufacturing company, has invested in a startup in Delhi called Asset22 Motors, and they are coming up with a model for re-swapping the batteries. M-Plus, which is again another indigenously manufactured vehicle, and it is a superbike and has a stylized quotient as well. As far as Ola and Uber is concerned, Ola has set up a battery swapping station right outside Delhi with a $250 million of investment by the conglomerate SoftBank. Take example of the Yulu. That's the best example for the indigenous technology that has come up right now. Amit Gupta, the CEO, talks about indigenizing it with the value-driven perspective to about 70 to 80%. Also, there are about 150 SME e-rickshaws that have come up in the last 5 years. If this is not transition, then I wonder what is. Also, as far as the technical aspects are concerned, it has a belt drive which gives it a high pickup. There's a low maintenance, one-time investment cost. Also, there are initiatives that have been coming up for battery swapping as opposed to battery charging, which reduces the land resources use as well as saves time to, you know, stand in the long queues for charging the entire thing. And this transition couldn't have come at a better position when our country is going at a pollution rate is going at an alarming high rate. Almost 19 out of 35 globally polluted cities are from India. We are almost at the fourth position as far as the CO2 emission is concerned and third in terms of GHGs. I wonder if people will be fearing in the future to walk down the roads due to the sulfur out there in the atmosphere. And we don't need another New Delhi, right? And then we talk about green GDP, and then we talk about sustainability goals. All this at the stake of fuel consumption that India is going, almost 30% of our fuel consumption is domestically met. Yes, everything is being imported from outside. And if we continue to go 100% electric, by 2030 we'll be saving around 1 gigatons of emissions by 2030. And in line with this, government has come up with many of the initiatives as recent as the GST 5% reduction in the budget 2019. It has also reduced the custom duty on the lithium-ion import. Also, the Make in India initiative has been carried out so that the local manufacturing companies come up with their own setup here in India. As far as the Bloomberg report is concerned, the IC engine, taken for around 7 years or so, will still produce less, will produce more emission as compared to the electric vehicles. And with renewable energy to back it up, there's nothing like it. So I would like to conclude on saying that we definitely need to have an alternative option that we give to the audience, at least a substitute to go for it. And looking at the short-term distance traveling as a transition, as opposed to imitating what is out there in the West. And definitely the future for this is path-breaking. Thank you.
Jeevana, I have a question for you. I'm a little confused with your anecdote on Delhi with your stand on the topic. Firstly, Delhi's problem was automotive in the late 90s and the early 2000s. Today, it is more compounded than that. Delhi was one of the first states that moved to non-conventional energy for public transport when Sheila Dixit was the chief minister. I am a little confused and I don't know what your stand is when you put an anecdote on Delhi with your stance. Could you just explain and clarify, please?
Sure. So, as you rightly said, there have been initiatives to compensate for that. But that city has been the first affected. So, you know, getting things like electric vehicles there would be the need of the hour to start off with. So, in that sense, I gave the example of New Delhi.
What you're saying is that it is the need of the hour, and you're saying you're not ready. What are you waiting for? I mean, what I didn't hear is what the government should not be waiting for, and what we need to do.
So I said it in terms of the green GDP and the sustainability goals and the rising pollution that's taking place. So in that sense, we don't need another New Delhi.
About the infrastructure, you talked about the vehicles and the range, etc. But what about the readiness of infrastructure in India?
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, that's true. But what I'm trying to understand is, you didn't touch about the topics related. What about infrastructure?
Well, charging infrastructure is required in our country. So it's not that we have, in cities, naturally space is going to be an issue. But if you live in maybe a small town somewhere, then it won't be an issue. And I also mentioned about the garages. Not everyone owns a garage. And if there isn't fast charging, it takes around 12 hours. So it's preferable to charge a vehicle in the garage.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Everyone, I'm Aishwarya Chandrasekhar, and I will be speaking for the topic, India is not yet ready for the transition of electric vehicles. First of all, let's take a look at the battery cost. Now, most of the electric vehicles run on lithium-ion batteries, which weigh a massive 500 kg, consisting of numerous lithium-ion cells. Now, 65% of the lithium reserves are in Bolivia and Chile, and 60% of the cobalt reserves are in Congo. Due to short supply, both of these have become expensive, and India has to import them with an additional GST. No doubt, 70% of the costs of the electric vehicles in two-wheelers amount to this, and 50% of the cost of cars amount to the battery. So electric vehicles is the future, but the future will happen only if there is a next generation inexpensive battery that is available in the market. The second issue is the power supply crisis. Now, we need not go to rural India to understand this. If you go to the outskirts of any Tier 1 city like Mumbai, load shedding is a common occurrence. There are power cuts varying from half an hour to 1 hour to a few hours. Now, because of these inconsistent power supplies and power surges, there is a high possibility that the expensive hardware of the electric vehicles will be damaged, and the massive battery pack is also damaged. The third is the charging station infrastructure. Now, one of the toughest challenges that India faces is the in terms of service integration is the setting up of level 2 charging stations in the public domain. The first challenge is for the normal charging, the time constraint is a problem, and for fast and DC charging, the cost and the high renewable energy is a problem. In a country where people are losing their lives for uninsulated wires that are not attended by local self-governing bodies. Have we ever thought of fire accidents that can happen in the charging stations? As early as 30th March of 2018, an e-rickshaw charging station in Naglapattu in Meerut was gutted out, and the electric vehicles were charred in the inferno. The fundamental question that we need to ask ourselves is that, are we compromising on the quality just to increase the numbers? Now, the Government of India, Ministry of Power, has stated that 54.3% of its energy comes from coal and a meager 12.6% comes from renewable resources. The Ministry also states that a total of 64% of its energy comes from thermal sources, a power scenario that is completely contrasting to a power scenario a country is supposed to have, especially if it's planning for electric vehicle mobility. Also, the Government of India's Niti Aayog has analyzed the data to show that the share of coal-based power in the country's energy mix is going to be 53% by the end of 2030, as opposed to 47% in the present. Another research recently conducted by a Zuri researcher tried to calculate the total undesirable side effects of 7,861 coal plants all around the world and concluded that India takes the highest toll when it comes to population. So a deadly misconception here would be to attribute sustainability to electric vehicles. If dirty coal continues to be a part of India's energy policy, then battery-powered vehicles will not be a solution for our air pollution use. Thank you.
A very wonderful good afternoon to one and all. I, Divyansh Tripathi, is standing before you all to express my views against the given topic, that is, India is not yet ready for the transition of electric vehicles. My debate will be split into three key areas, beginning with the meaning of electric vehicles, background of electric vehicles, and the government initiatives. What are electric vehicles? Electric vehicles, unlike conventional fuel, diesel, petrol vehicles, uses one or more electric motors for propulsion. While the global electric vehicle market is rapidly gaining momentum towards the target set by the Electric Vehicle Initiative of achieving 20 million electric vehicles by 2030. Yes, India is ready, and in order to support this statement, few points to be noted are: India has been constantly manufacturing the electric vehicles indigenously and is successfully using the train locomotives that pulls train coaches which carry thousands of tons of loads. This has not only saved the conventional fuels, but has also saved the environment from getting polluted further. According to the recent study by Niti Aayog, India can save up to 64% of anticipated road-based mobility and 34% of the carbon emissions that can be achieved by 2030, pursuing a shared electric and common mobility future. Apart from this, the study shows that as a signatory to the Paris Climate Agreement, India is obliged to bring down its share of emissions by 2030. And in order to achieve this, the Government of India is making key initiatives such as launch of e-mobility program and providing guidelines to encourage the use of electric vehicles by Niti Aayog. Electric vehicles is the need for the hour. I guess this is the very first definite statement made by the Government of India. In reference to this, our Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman announced an additional income tax exemption of Rs 1.5 lakh for the buyers of electric vehicles in the budget 2019-20. She also said about lowering of tax from 12% to 5%. Now coming to the government initiatives, today electric vehicles has become the biggest business opportunity in India that we have. As for the last year, Electricity Sufficient Limited told that they have passed on the tenders to procure at least 100 electric vehicles to support the government vehicles in New Delhi. And the tenders were awarded to the leading automobile makers, Tata Motors and Mahindra & Mahindra. Later on, we can also see the facts that the South Korean electric company market has told that they are planning to launch electric vehicles in the end of 2019. Now coming to the question that what electric vehicles work on. They work on lithium-ion batteries. This is a quite a debatable question, as they are costly because they are imported from outside. But in a recent interview, former ISRO chairman Kiran Kumar said that we have started building the lithium-ion batteries, which constitute about 26 processes, which are now currently used for the vehicle missions and also for the satellites. If these are made indigenously, they can definitely reduce the cost of electric vehicles in India. At last, I would like to conclude by quoting, "Transportation is transforming and we need to get ready. We will not stop until every car on the road is electric. In order to have clean air in the cities, we have to go electric." Thank you.
In your panel question, one is, there is no mention of a consumer, because policymakers and consumers always don't see eye to eye. What are your thoughts on how consumer is going to adapt from what you said? Because you spoke about public transport and you spoke about more of scientific nature of what EV can do, but that's not about the consumer.
To get attracted towards these policies, government is organizing some of the training programs. Like, many people are not familiar, as they come from a background that they cannot go for a such huge amount of money to buy those electric vehicles. So for that, the government is incentivizing, giving them subsidies. Like I mentioned, that in the recent budget year, they have also been awarded with the lowering of GST rate from 12% to 5%. And the programs which they are conducting, like, they are providing guidelines to increase the impact of electric vehicles to 1% to 1%.
Common mobility agenda. One of the things you said was common mobility agenda that the Niti Aayog with the government of India. Can you just explain what that is in a little bit more detail?
Like Niti report stated, that if India works in a chronological manner, they can get reduced up to 67% of the automobile road based mobility. Like the vehicles which are run on a daily basis on road emits lots of carbon emissions, which is depleting our environment. So they imposed a report, like, if we want to save our mother earth, so we can get 67% reduction in that road-based mobility, and next to that we can get carbon emissions reduced to 37%. In order to achieve this, we should have a shared mobility growth, which you asked about. So in that, we can do like that, if we are having some common mobility program, you know, operated by the government of India. So the people who are willing to go into such fields, like, there are lots of awareness programs going on. So if they want to work towards the benefit of our nature, because as far as the researchers told, that we coal resources and all conventional fuels will get over for the another 20 or 30 years. So this is the right time, so we should go electric. So like that, Niti Aayog developed a report so that people can go forward and work in the field of electric vehicles.
By calling it Mother Earth, we've already martyred it, so it's okay.
Secondly, the statistics says that it requires rupees 9 lakh for the construction of each charging point. People, you may now calculate the amount required for the construction of charging station all over the country. Question yourself, is India economically this stable? If you say yes, then what about $543 million that India has to pay to the World Bank today? Our great people say, let us transfer to electrical vehicles and reduce the rising pollution. I think before quoting this, they should know the amount of pollution and the danger that the lithium extraction can cause to the atmosphere. India is an electric deficient country. There are 204 million people living in India today without electricity. From where is India going to supply electricity in this scenario? Construction of nuclear power plants? No ways. Again, the matter of economy and the hazards that can cause is unimaginary. Our great leader Mahatma Gandhiji once said, education is the basic tool for the development of nation. What is happening in India today? India is not even able to fund our own education. Then what about funding on the automobile industry? Designing the automobile industry today is not the simple matter of today and tomorrow. I have a question. How many mechanics have India prepared today to face the problems of electrical vehicles? For Indians, vehicle is not a luxury, it's a requirement. I repeat, it's not a luxury, it's a requirement. Suddenly, if India calls for the transition to electrical vehicles, from where are the population getting the electrical vehicles? The national anthem itself says that India is filled with hill and mountain ranges. In such a diverse geographical country, having a electrical vehicles which is less efficient with a speed of 50 to 100 miles is unimaginary again. In Kannada, we have a saying that Asige iddaste kaalu chaachu. India has to do something within the available resources. People, you may go in and around Bangalore today having the count on potholes and the traffic that you face. This will give you a clear picture how much India is ready for the transition to electrical vehicles. To conclude with this, I say that India is not yet ready for the transition of electrical vehicles in any ways. First, let it fulfill all the basic requirements, develop people's mentality. People, no strong building can be built without the strong foundation. Thank you.
By not speaking among yourselves is required. Thank you.
Everybody, my name is Jason, and I'm very much against the statement that India is not ready to transition to electric vehicles. Let me tell you a fact. Each and every day, there are at least 180 traffic police officers who are admitted to medical care because of respiratory and breathing problems. I would like you to take a moment and imagine the benefits that we can have with this transition. The statement clearly says that we have to make a transition to electric vehicles and not make a sudden change. So, granted that we lack the significant infrastructure, we lack some technology, but a transition is a slow process. If not all of you, then most of you would have already heard by now that Hyundai has recently launched its first electronic vehicle called the Hyundai Kona. Now, the Hyundai Kona has been awarded for being the best electronic vehicle, the best electronic consumer-friendly vehicle to have ever been launched. Not only of the year 2018 or of 19, to have ever been launched. Despite having a steep price of 24 lakh rupees, it has been sold out in South Korea. It is trending in Japan, and there are already 300 bookings in Chennai alone. That was 2 months ago. That is where the construction for these cars are taking place. Now let us come to some hard facts. It is not wrong for me to agree when the opposition says that we lack infrastructure, we lack technology. We have to import lithium, which is rich in China. And despite having such a big debt, it is quite a difficult thing to think about. Are we really ready for this transition? Yes, we are to make slow progress because the first cell phone that came out, you could only call and you could only receive messages. Now when you have an electric vehicle, definitely, okay, it has got slow pickup. If at all, you know, you cannot exactly travel very easily with that. There are potholes, we'll not be able to manage on the roads. But a transition, it will evolve. The cell phone evolved. Mankind is evolving. The electric car will evolve. We will definitely find a way. Electric vehicles are not only going to cut down on our strong, heavy reliance on coal. We make use of that. We pollute the environment so much that we are only coming to realize it now. What is the use of talking about it? Now is the time for action. There's no time to talk anymore. Show support to your engineers and your scientists who are taking the time to develop electric efficient vehicles because it saves us that much. Hyundai is a smaller brand from South Korea when compared to business giants like Tesla, BMW, Porsche, Niro. These are brands which have been around for a very long time and they have already stepped foot into the electric industry. If a small company compared to them, of Hyundai, is able to create the best electronic car as of now, and when it has such a strong market here in India, Hyundai has a strong market in India, do you not see the possibility in the upcoming years where instead of seeing fuel-efficient cars, we see electric-efficient cars? Have faith in your scientists, have faith in the science. Have faith that eventually, as the years keep going by, India will find a way. We got independence against the British, that seemed very impossible. We recently landed on the moon, that definitely seemed very impossible. It's only a matter of time before we can set an example to ourselves, to our own people, that whatever is impossible, we can prove otherwise. Have faith in the system, have faith in electricity, and have faith in the economics. Thank you.
I wanted your opinion on what is geography, potholes, and people mentality got to do with EV adoption? I couldn't figure out who said that we have a differentiated geography. And you said we have potholes, and you said people mentality. In what context were you saying that these three things need to be addressed before we move to EV?
Okay, let me first speak about the mountain ranges and that I spoke. Electrical vehicles are less efficient vehicle. So it doesn't have the mileage and power as good as the vehicles we have now. A longer time to travel. For example, I just traveled from Mangalore to Bangalore yesterday. So it took 9 hours to travel in an Volvo bus. So traveling in an electrical vehicle, I think it will take double of time.
Okay.
And about the potholes, now for example, the present vehicle itself, if the road is not good, the alignment of the wheels is going to spoil.
Okay.
So electrical vehicle, they are basically made of lithium ion batteries. So the batteries might also get damaged and then be damaged in vehicles. I think electrical vehicles are not so well built for the potholes. Then about the people's mentality, now and then we hear that there is blasting of phones with that small batteries itself. So having vehicles with such a large battery, lithium batteries are very sensitive for getting charged more and discharged. So I think first India has to prepare the people for it and then adopt. Thank you.
Jason, a question to you. You put forward a very compelling argument of how we are ready for transition. In this argument, did you give a thought to what would be the financial or the economic impact of transition, given that a lot of money has been invested in the current production capabilities India has? Did you look at that aspect, or you just sort of didn't figure it while you were making your argument? So if you did, what's your view?
You had mentioned about the economics that it has because of the financial aid that we have from other nations because of the...
No, I didn't say that.
Six.
I said when you were making an argument about that we will adopt electric vehicles and that adoption will be a transition. In the transition argument, did you factor the transition that the industry needs to take into cognizance, given that billions of dollars have been invested in current car or automotive production capabilities? Did you factor that, or you did not go that way?
I went that way, so I think I just did not make it clear enough.
So what do you think is the impact?
India imports a lot of fuel from foreign countries for automobile consumption. The same fuel that we are importing and the same fuel that we are using over here can be used to power generators, which can be provided to the people where they do not have any electricity. So with this transition, if at all we use an electric vehicle, we can provide the same electricity which people are deprived of using the same fuel that we are consuming to where it is required the most.
A paper that talks about the cost-benefit analysis of transitioning way back, I think, in the early 2000s. I think his question was more around, have you done that study? About how batteries cause alignment and balancing issues in cars. I mean, after so many years of driving, I couldn't drive cognizance to that. Batteries
just gave an example.
So on that note, I mean, 5 seconds.
Use this one, this doesn't need 5 seconds.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
5 and a half and six.
It's actually electric vehicles. Heard the word electrical, electronic over the last two sessions. Electric vehicle, right? Is it not? So please ensure that. Just a syntax.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Jasmine Lofa Mascarenas. I will be speaking for the motion.
I am Terence Gonsalves and will be speaking against the motion.
So, green, go green or get bulldozed. India is a power hunger country with a supply of only 175 gigawatts of electricity, but we need 177 gigawatts of electricity. It is about 1.49 gigawatts deficit. It's not the launch that matters, it's the run. In a technology agnostic country such as India, where we don't just cater to the business problems with one kind of technology, the electric vehicles came into focus. But they failed to gain a widespread market share. Only 7.5 lakhs electric cars were sold against 3.4 million passenger cars and 21 million two-wheelers. The hurdle for the electric vehicles ramp up is the inefficient electric vehicle ecosystem. Well, this ecosystem consists of the charging infrastructure and the manufacturing of battery cells, motors, and controllers. Talking about the charging infrastructure, we need a robust technology to suffice this and storage and utilization of this energy. Well, we have only about 10,000 charging points all over India currently, where our very own capital, New Delhi, will require about 3 lakh charging points. How are we going to run our vehicles if we don't have electricity to survive the rain? Well, we have around 23 million villages which don't have sufficient electricity. Mr. Vishnu Mathur, the Director General of the Society of Automobile Manufacturers, said, he recently visited Mukteshwar. He had only 7 hours of electricity for around 4 days. When we can't suffice our own people, how will we run our electric cars? Well, around 80% of our electricity is generated through fossil fuels, which not even contributes to around 24% of efficiency of our cars. Well, our now petrol and diesel vehicles provide around 20 to 22% efficiency. If our electric vehicles even provide 10% more efficiency, it will only benefit about 3.33%. Well, it's just a negligible amount for what we have now. And talking about the battery cells, motors and controllers. Well, our battery requires lithium and cobalt as the main component. Lithium runs it, cobalt cools it. Well, we have China, Bolivia, Chile and the Republic of Congo supplying these materials. Well, though China has its own reserves, they are trying to monopolize the market by getting more reserves from other places so that they have an upper hand there. My question is that, will we have to be under China to run our electric vehicles? Well, the answer is this. The thing is, we have to develop a technology where we can produce cheaper batteries so that our overall cost suffices. Well, we go to see, when we go and buy a car, first we see the cost, mileage, efficiency. First we ask is, kitna deti hai? Anyone asks us how much it gives. Well, the more kilometers we want to run it, the weight increases, which affects the mileage. And in a place like India, where patience and time, we both don't want to sacrifice. How are we going to wait till our vehicle charges? Though there are turbo charges, do we have the capacity to do it? Thank you, guys.
It is alarming that India's oil imports have elevated to 84%, putting at stake the country's economy, environment and human life at risk. And I think now it's time to think and switch to electric vehicles. An amazing initiative by the government, where the Union Cabinet has cleared 10,000 crore rupees for the promotion of electric vehicles, followed by reduction to GST to 5% by 12 and 18% on electric vehicles and electric chargers. The depleting fossil fuels itself is creating market for electric vehicles. Next, among the 20 most polluted cities in the world, 13 are in India, and 20 to 30% of the pollution is caused by petrol and diesel vehicles, which causes cardiovascular and respiratory diseases, brain dysfunction and cancer. Apart from that, the smoke which combines with the atmospheric water vapor causes acid rain, which is something worse than a curse. Are we really dependent on China for lithium batteries? No. India has partnered with Bolivia, which is providing us lithium carbonate in abundance. Toshiba and Denso Corporations have formed a joint venture with Suzuki Motors to set up manufacturing facilities of lithium batteries in Gujarat. Panasonic is putting all its efforts to provide services of charging stations with turbo charging facilities, plus top-up chargers wherein batteries can be easily swapped and vehicles need not wait for a long time. Next, return on investment and cost effectiveness. The cost for charge, it takes only less than 1 rupee per kilometer, wherein all the vehicles, for example, electric Hyundai Kona provides 450 kilometer, Mahindra Innova provides 200 to 250 kilometer, Revolt provides 150 kilometer, and that is what return on investment and cost, and cost effectiveness is. Next, electricity is needed. I know more than 60% of electricity comes from thermal power plants, but India and US have signed a bilateral agreement where it will build nuclear power plants in India, and it will cause no harm and effectiveness, no harm and no pollution. Well, Mahindra and Mahindra have set up their has a separate plant in Chakana, Pune, for electric vehicles itself. Hyundai will be assembling its electric vehicles in its Chennai-based plants itself. Now, an internal combustion engine consists of 2,000 and more parts, but an electric vehicle consists of only 20 parts. Here, the employees in the manufacturing unit might have to undergo a few changes, but learning is always a part of our life. So here, the electric vehicles will also create 10 million jobs in the field of business, IT, R&D and engineering. Now, I say eventually that India has to change. We can't be laggards and stay until our earth, our planet get destroyed. We have to overcome dogmatism towards our traditional approach and accept the modern changes to which will benefit us, the nation and the society. Yesterday there was a question which arose asking if India is really ready for fuel cars. And today we know the answer. Today we have this question arising, asking if we are ready for electric cars, and tomorrow we will be the answer. Hence, I say that India is ready and has to be ready for electric vehicles. Thank you.
Understand the correlation between heart diseases, cancer and petrol vehicles. You gave that, no?
Yes. Cancer. Because
is there a basis of any study you have referred to, or is it just out of how have you arrived at that inference? I just want to understand that a little better. Because in that case, I think we need to ban all petrol cars or diesel cars.
Yes, sir. We are already aware of it, because all the emission, the smoke, the emission consists of soot, carbon monoxide, which causes lung diseases, and all these diseases, we are already aware of it. In Delhi,
I don't know. Where are you referring to? Which report or which particular analysis? Are you referring to any particular study or any particular? How are you referring?
After referring to all the studies and after referring to all the studies, I have stated this.
Which study?
Give an example of one study.
Because we have all the studies, health and report sciences, and on internet, I've referred to those.
Thank you.
Yes. Any other questions?
I have a question. I was happy that in the beginning, during introduction, you talked about two-wheeler. What is your take on the electrification for two-wheelers?
Electric vehicles usually have a smaller battery, so battery swapping for that could be encouraged. But the thing is that, sir, customer awareness is something which we are lacking. When I go somewhere and ask anyone, what would you prefer? They will go to a customized, like a normal showroom of petrol and electric, the petrol and diesel ones, and they'll buy a petrol two-wheeler. I feel, sir, it'll run, but customer awareness is very important in our current market now.
Naveen Kelvin Dalmeda, replacing Vishnu Dev. Hearty good evening to one and all present here. The motion for the day is that India is not yet ready to transition to electric vehicles, and I'm here to speak for the motion. Over the course of my defense, I shall highlight how our nation lacks a robust system of superchargers. I will probe the Indian psyche with regard to the mentality towards electric vehicles, and I should also comment on the lack of innovation in this field and the lack of incentivization for said innovation. Firstly, let me draw a parallel to the Tesla model prevalent in the United States of America, particularly in California. In order for Tesla to succeed and to achieve the heights it has done today is their network of superchargers. Recently, in early September, Porsche released their Taycan model. However, along with the car, they failed to release a network superchargers, which is central towards the success of electric vehicles. Now let us come back to our own beloved peninsula. We do not have a network of superchargers or even normal chargers for that matter within our roadway systems. In order for a transition to electric vehicles to succeed and even thrive for that matter, we need to replace our petrol stations with superchargers, and because of the efficiency of petrol versus a kilowatt of electricity, we may even need twice the number. Now this is not something that can be done overnight and will probably be a multi-decade project if it has to be undertaken. Next, the mentality of our nation towards our beloved gas-powered vehicles. The idea is that car is a symbol of wealth, a status symbol in fact. To have a car is the next ladder in your life. However, this mentality is deeply rooted, but the same notion does not currently exist towards electric vehicles. To the contrary, there seems to be a notion that electric vehicles are somehow inferior, these tiny, funny-looking battery cars that do not make the familiar sounds and whose clutch doesn't feel the same anymore. That change is important, because while we may laugh about it, this is the psyche of our nation, and any change, or no matter what the scale is, has to be in tandem with the psyche of our nation, and currently that simply isn't the case. Next is the innovation. For any massive change to occur, there needs to be state-sponsored innovation. Currently, the push for electric vehicles is merely to be in compliance with the Paris Climate Change Agreement. We are all well aware how seriously this agreement is being taken on a global scale. However, in order for this to succeed, for electric vehicles to become a reality in India, we require a more robust system, more strong policy, and that currently doesn't exist. As I conclude, I would like to stress that I'm not being a pessimistic fool here who loves our highly polluting vehicles. No, I do foresee a future, probably towards the end of the 21st century, when the streets of India will reverberate with the nice hum, sleek hum of electric vehicles. But that day isn't today, and that era is in this current era. Till then, we have to sit back and wait for the twilight. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Baiman Mirada Alanda. The motion is the opposition's creation, meant to generate sensation. Now some will scream, some will shout, but allow me to clear your doubts. The motion for today's debate is, India is not yet ready for transition to electric vehicles. And I am against it. Why? Because change is inevitable. Change is the only thing that is constant. From letters to telephones to mobile phones to smartphones, from bullock cars to motor cars to electric vehicles, we are upgrading. Not only are we upgrading, we can save the planet from global warming, from greenhouse effects. In a few years' time, if this goes on, I'm afraid we have to rewrite the nursery rhymes and teach our kids what? Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up above the sky so high, looking down at extremely high levels of carbon dioxide in the sky. Friends, from kerosene, from candles to light bulbs, from, you know, traditionally heating up the water at the fireplace to a switch of the geyser. We have come a long way in curbing the emissions of carbon dioxide. And electric vehicles can do so much more. Now let's go to the components of the electric vehicles. Number one, battery. It is a key component. Yeah, we were heavily dependent upon China, Taiwan, and Japan for its import. But with the memorandum of understanding signed between India and Bolivia, the second largest producer of lithium, domestic production is set to a boost, which is evident from the productions of Tata, XIME Industries, Bell, and the list can go on. Now, what do we do with the batteries after we swap them? Do we just dispose them and create another havoc? No. With the green chemistry, we can actually recover and restore the lithium-ion battery cathode material called lithium cobalt oxide, which is used in smartphones and laptops. Now, what about the charging stations,
charging points? Are they affordable? Are they accessible? Well, thanks to, you know, Tata Motors and a few more industries who supported the Indian government, they have set up a lot of charging points presently in Mumbai, Delhi, Hyderabad, and coming down to Bangalore, Mysore. It is going viral. Now, is there another alternative for this? India is a tropical country. We receive the maximum sunlight. So Magenta, in collaboration with Exigun, they have set up charging points, you know, by harnessing their solar energy. And moving on, are these affordable? That is the main thing. Are they marketable? Yes, because electricity is far cheaper as compared to the imported gas, isn't it? And then, the government stepping here when Nirmala Sitharaman has reduced the GST rate from 12% to 5%. And another point I would like to say is that, you know, the Indian roads are really bumpy. Maybe that is why we don't really have amusement parks in Northeast. And that is where Tata with a Zipthron have come up with their powertrain, custom-made vehicles for Indian roads. So before I take my seat, I urge my friends to go for cleaner air, less reliance on imported oil, and strive to be number one in the high-tech industries. Because it is not just a car, it is a lifestyle, a passion, a release. Thank you.
You got quick answers. You said the government does not have a policy to promote electric vehicle in India?
A robust policy, sir.
What do you mean by that?
I'm aware that we...
Quickly.
I'm aware there's a 2030 policy, but I'm talking something on the scale of the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, something that is there across our nation. That is what is missing, a robust policy.
Fair. Second is that you said that for mass change to happen, state-sponsored innovation is required. What do you mean by that?
The government must provide funding towards agencies and research laboratories and research centers in general to produce technology.
Because that's completely opposite to what people say, that they don't want states to be involved in funding. They would like state to have policies. So are you getting confused somewhere, or are you very clear about what you want?
I am stuck. Okay, I'll take the example of our space research and our programs in space. Because the government has put in their capital and their money into it, we've been able to afford to make mistakes. Similarly, it's a trip to the moon will be space government sponsored, but then the private industries can come in and give us commercial flights to the moon in that sense.
I have one question to ask. If you were invited to make a Swachh Bharat kind of policy to be implemented around electric vehicles, what would it be?
That is a good question, ma'am.
It's not a great answer.
I'm not a policy maker, and I definitely lack the nuance that is required for it, but I think I think we should make in India, the most popular phones used are the budget smartphones, not our iPhones. Current Teslas are $150,000. The Taycan is, I think, $180,000. So a campaign should incentivize a person to A, purchase an electric vehicle, and make it affordable, or give the industries incentives to produce it at an affordable rate, initially, till the transition occurs. I think that would be a good starting point, at least. Because at the moment, if I'm not mistaken, there are a few public buses that exist, and there was an experiment done wherein an Alto was fitted with a solar panel in an attempt for a green car. However, the design was...
Motor Vehicles Act will no longer allow anything on the rooftop.
Exactly. And further, it was mocked by as very poor design as well. So more should be done. I feel what is happening right now is too little and perhaps even too superficial. But that's just my opinion.
You know, I was just wondering, these days a lot of us are policy makers on social media. I was just wondering whether you were one of those.
Thank you.
being a developing nation, there are few points that impact for the transition to electric vehicles, and I would like to quote a few of them. First of all, the basic need for electric vehicles are 24 hours electricity, or else continuous supply of electricity. So there are many cities in India where we find 6 to 7 hours or 5 to 6 hours of power cut in a day. So this becomes a task for the government so that they keep a continuous power supply for the nation. And the next thing is the network of the charging power stations. So once you we opt for these electric vehicles, it is very necessary that we get these charging power stations very nearby, and the network must be a huge one and throughout the nation. But the point is, do we have so many electric power stations right now? We have around 2,000 electric stations in India, but Delhi alone needs 3 lakh electric power stations. So we can see the difference, and is it ready? Are we having such electric power stations, or do we have time to install all these power stations, is one of my points. And the technical know-how, the technology and the batteries are being imported, and we are paying import duties on all of these. So is it affordable for a common man, is the next point. The main motive of this transition to electric vehicle is taking a step towards carbon negative nation. So is this happening, is the next point. So the electronic waste that is coming out of all these electric vehicles must be disposed properly, or else the pollution would be hazardous. And we have to make sure that all these electronic waste are disposed properly. The other point is, India has 54.4% electricity is coming out from the thermal power stations. That is through coal. And coal is one of the major carbon dioxide producing agent. So we have to make sure that we are not, are we going carbon negative, or are we just changing our route towards the pollution, or we are changing from the carbon dioxide emission to the environment, to the electronic waste disposal pollution. So we have to make sure that there are a lot of renewable energy resources for the power stations, and we have to make sure that the networking of the power stations are more. Thank you.
I'm Shashank, and I present my case against the topic that India is not ready for a transition to electric vehicles. First off, let me chisel out the two types of engines that we're talking about. ICE, internal combustion engines, and electric vehicles. So ICE uses commercial fuels like petrol and diesel, whereas electric vehicles use galvanic cells that are mounted into batteries, and that's how electric vehicles work. So according to a survey that was created by the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gases, as on March 31st, 2018, India was using 201.9 million tons of crude oil, which is one of the major contributors to the suspended particulate matter emission in the atmosphere, which is a class 1 cancer causing agent. So that is the amount of pollution that this is causing. And when I say that India is indeed ready for a transition to electric vehicles, I say this with the fact that India has been predominantly manufacturing and using electric locomotives that pull thousands tons of loads of coaches every day. And I don't see why that can't be used to power cars. So that's one of my first points. Next, we have hybrid cars that are coming up. Toyota is manufacturing some hybrid cars, and most of the other automobile giants. And suppose you run out on fuel, you can always depend on the battery, and vice versa. PM Narendra Modi, in the MOVE summit that was organized by NITI Aayog, said, or I can put it this way, planned that by 2030, he doesn't want a single ICE-powered vehicle to run on the streets of India. But I think that's not a viable idea. I think even if we reach 30 to 40% of that plan, I think that would work. Next. Recently, Tata Motors owned JLR, Jaguar, and Land Rover, signed a deal with BMW Group, and they are looking, they are eyeing at the title of being pioneers in electric vehicles manufacturing. Similarly, Mahindra and Mahindra and Ford joined hands on a joint venture, 1-for-1-1 crores, with 49 and 51% share. They are aiming to get electric vehicles to India and make it pocket friendly to these spaces. Next. Okay, when someone argues that what if we run out on batteries in the middle of a nice ride? Well, there are around 60,999 petrol bunks in India as on November 2017 census. So cut down half of that and erect some 30,000 power charging stations, and a battery charged vehicle would run up to 500 kilometers in one shot, so I don't think why that would be a issue. And come down to cities, metropolitan cities, we have few giants like the food delivery giants like Swiggy, Zomato, and Uber Eats who are considering the other fact that we should switch over to electric vehicles to actually deliver food, which I think is viable and an economical option as well, and light on the pockets of the delivery boys as well. So finally, I'd like to say that take control before the situation escapes from your hand. Thank you.
There was a very palpable pause between nice and right. Were you planning to insert another word in the middle?
I'm sorry, I didn't get you.
It's a very palpable pause between nice and right. Were you looking to insert a word in between?
No, just fumbling.
You were just fumbling?
I just fumbled.
Right. I can't see what's on your t-shirt, so I really couldn't gather what you were trying to say.
Okay.
Sorry. No, you don't have to repeat it.
The question, you are comparing trains and electrification versus vehicles. What is the real comparison?
Actually, in one sector where for mass transportation, where we can actually run the whole train, which India being the largest railway connected network, I think when we can afford such a nice and a huge amount of, we can go to that range to power a whole mass transportation. I don't see why we can't go ahead and power, you know, private vehicles that way as well.
The
battery operated electric vehicles.
Were you contemplating the?
Yeah, I was aiming at two wheelers. You know, the battery operated vehicles are on two wheelers. So I think the maximum speed I'll achieve, and one point is that it would avoid accidents as well. So
can you elaborate a little bit?
Adoption. Switching over from petrol run two wheelers to electric vehicles. The companies like Hero, they have their own battery operated vehicles. So I was talking about adoption, the shift over.
Shivani, just a quick one. You talked of electronic race and a very pertinent point. Can you share very quickly in 30 seconds a little bit more about your understanding of the challenge electronic race poses?
So there are a lot of electronic race such as refrigerators or air coolers.
With respect to EV.
Okay, so the lithium batteries. So when you come to the batteries, what happens when, if in case water enters or you are not...
How big is it as a waste management problem? How severe and big is it?
No, the point is, not many of us are aware of how it is, how the electronic wastes are disposed or how can they be reused or recycled. So basic thing is, people have to get more knowledge on this and how to use it or how to recycle it in order to know. And for this, the government have to make sure that they educate more and they give more advertisements and awareness on how this acts.
Thank you.
Thank you, judges.
Thank you. It is considered to be one of the fastest growing economies in the world. But one needs to mind that it is also home for the most polluted countries in the world. According to the UN, states that 22 most polluted countries out of the 30 come from India. So with this growing concerns across the globe, most of the countries have come together and signed the Paris Commune in order to ensure the air quality and the pollution is reduced. But in this regard, India has also envisioned itself to convert all its accommodation towards electric vehicles. So I am here to speak for the motion saying that India is not yet ready for electric transition. So I would like to support this by sharing few facts. First of all, I would like to completely divide it into internal parts and external parts. Coming to the internal side of the whole issue, the first thing, the battery itself. Made out of lithium, electric vehicles and the batteries are like heart and the body. Lithium is being mostly produced by first is Australia, next China, and then China. If you are really planning that we can import lithium to it, mind it that India has a trade deficit with China to around $60 billion as of 2018. If you are more smart enough in order to ensure that you have developed something indigenously and making your own batteries, mind about the charging infrastructure. There is no standardization regarding the charging infrastructure, as in what is the standards that you use. Is it CSH2 or CHADEMO or the Bharat, which has been launched newly. So there is also lack of standardization when it comes to charging infrastructure, and also a country which is the seventh largest needs to have n number of charging infrastructure facilities for supporting this. Next is the performance of the battery. You all know that Indian climate is typically tropical and the temperatures are around 40, which is very common for Indians. At this point of temperature, batteries cannot give their best when you compare it with any other country. So coming to the external part, as in what are the problems and stating that India is not yet ready, the first thing is job loss. Electric vehicles only have a very less number of moving parts than compared to the IC engines. So what do you think will happen to the role of the ancillary industries which are producing this moving parts? There is going to be a shift in the whole economy and India is not ready for it. And next, I would like to also state a statement saying that we all know that the education in India is mostly prominently dominated by engineering. We all know that according to AICTE's official website dashboard stating that 20 lakh plus engineering and technology students have been graduated, and among them only 6 lakh people have been placed. This is on official records. Then consider the rate of unemployment. Now considering this as one of the facts, now we speak. Electric vehicles are someone who requires electrical engineers rather than mechanical or people from IT or CSE background. So there is also a shift in the total employment that is going to be happening in India, and we feel that India is ready enough immediately to implement it. This is a still great question that everybody has to think. And also coming to the policy frameworks, leapfrogging the BS6 by 2020 and also asking us to ensure that by 2030 the EV vehicles in 2- and 3-wheeler is going to be a reality. Don't you feel that there is something that is being imbalanced? So all such issues have to be considered before stating that India is ready for the electric vehicle transition. So with this, I would like to conclude saying that yes, we need a lot of time and India should be future ready, but as a present point of time, it is not yet ready for the EV transition. Thank you for this opportunity.
For the past decade, Indian automobile industry has been following an established curve. And when such established curve is about to reach its maturity, market throws in various discontinuity curves. One such count being electric vehicles. And seeing the rising import bill, which was $111 billion in the year 2018-19, I think it's imperative that India rides this disruptive curve. My friends sitting here who do not agree with me will think that there are many issues surrounding the EV ecosystem. But what we see as issues, I see as opportunities. And therefore, I think it's my civic duty to stand here and bring out what are these opportunities and burst the myths regarding it. Myth number one is regarding the battery itself, which we import from China, and it is felt that India will fall in the supply side squeeze with the Chinese country. But what they are forgetting is that India has taken conscious step. Besides launching a national vision on transformative mobility and battery storage, India is on the verge of launching the first Tesla-type gigafactory for EV battery in Telangana, where 100 acres of land is ready for this purpose. Not only this, notable step is taken by Indian Oil Corporation, in which they are focusing their energy to develop non-lithium-ion batteries with 100% India-centric. That is, raw material in India, manufactured in India, and the recyclable industries also present in India. Myth number two is that it will lead to loss of jobs. But technological advancement never leads to loss of jobs. It just leads to shift in jobs. Take the example of the humble e-rickshaw. It has led to 150 small-scale manufacturers, EV manufacturers in the country, which are not only earning their own keep but providing employment at the lowest, most level. What industries need to do is that they need to slowly transfer with your original technology, have EV technology as well, and then rotate your employees between these two. This way, the employees will learn this new skilling phases, and that elusive skill of cross-skilling will be available to the industry. Myth number three, that the pollution will remain at the same level. In a bell-to-wheel analysis conducted by Electric Power Research Institute, it was found that this is not true. Carbon footprint will decrease even if the source of electricity is coal. And if we take the path that India is taking, that is renewable energy, I think it's going to take one step forward, and EY reports that our carbon content will reduce by 40%. Myth number four, that EV is expensive and not for general people. Government has taken two steps in that. First, reduction of GST from 12% to 5%. Second, 1.5 lakh additional tax benefits on the interest of EV vehicle loans. If this also seems hi-fi, take the example of Bakarangi Kendra outlets, which have said that by year 2021-22, 75,000 of their outlets will have EV charging facility. Why I'm mentioning this point here? Because 68% of these outlets are present in entire five and tier six cities. So if this becomes possible, not only India will be on path of financial inclusion, but EV inclusion as well. What I'm trying to say here is that technology and transportation is transforming, and we need to be ready. From the campus of IIT Madras to the railway station of Mumbai, Delhi and Pune, Indira Gandhi International Airport, big corporate houses like Big Basket and IKEA, humble e-rickshaws, everybody has EV there. They are using EV. So I believe that they have done their job to save India from the clutches of the neighboring dragon. I believe that India is EV ready. Thank you.
I have a question for you. I'm a little, your whole argument about employment versus survival, causal condition of employment to a long-term issue of survival of humankind, I'm a little, it's jarring with...
My point is that we know what is the characteristics of Indian economy. It is completely consumer driven. So whenever there is lots of unemployment being happening, we'll lose the consumption pattern.
So it's okay to be consumerist, but not okay to be rational?
It's not completely
so against the principles of economics?
It is not completely deviating from the point that we should never consider the long-term survivability. It's all about like taking the change to a level at which it can take. It's like not immediately jumping into such kind of situation where people are lacking skills. At that point of time, we cannot perform well and we cannot give our best in such kind of things. So it needs time for them to train and get skilled and then to implement and deploy the technology.
In a follow-up on that, do you think you want the petrol diesel vehicles because we have so many engineers? Was that your argument?
Mechanical engineers.
It is not that we want it. It is like the way we are going to reduce it should be in a planned way.
Okay. I want to ask Ekta a question with the permission, and then we should be allowed three questions in this one. Sorry, Navin. Ekta, I quite liked your initial approach to the discontinuity curve. That's an economic topic that most people don't touch on innovation. Do you think you can recall an example of a discontinuity curve in the recent past from the time you were born that's impacted industry and consumer behavior? I mean, just a rhetorical question, but I'd like to know how much you know of the topic.
I think the first one...
Have you read the book Four Horses?
Not read the book, but I think I can give the example of telephone itself. While I was in my school life, there were still landlines, and we have to call it from there, in the mobile cellular technology to another level, and from landlines, which were attached to a fixed point in the house, we went mobile.
For your kind of research, I'd definitely like to recommend that you read the book Four Horses. It's a very interesting book on how e-commerce has changed the language among the four big guys.
Mm-hmm. News article that read, Reliance's share price jumped a massive 130 rupees in one single day. And this happened after Niti Aayog's announcement of going all electric by 2030. Now see, Reliance is a company whose core business is petroleum and refinery. So this came as a shock to me. So I started doing some digging. And that's when I found out that Reliance made a statement. It has increased this chemical complexity index to 21.1. So that means it is ready to manufacture chemicals that are required in batteries as well as renewable energy plants. Now this is important. But why am I talking about it? I'll let you know in a minute. Before that, I'm going to stay and I'm going to speak against the topic. So I've taken a wholesome approach to this entire topic, and I've divided my arguments into four sectors, which I have nicknamed it as the two EIC sector. One being the economy, two being the energy and environment, three being the infrastructure, and four being the customers. So coming on to economy, why did I speak about Reliance? Reliance makes up 2.8% of our entire GDP. It's one of the biggest conglomerates in our country, so it's important for Reliance to be ready. So that's a good sign. Now, talking about economy, let's go back to 2015 and understand how the government functions. In 2015, something important happened. On January 1st, Planning Commission of India was replaced by Niti Aayog. So now, the vision was to set long-term goals, a 15-year roadmap. So that's when the Startup India and Make in India concepts came out. So with Startup India, what really happened is, companies like Ather Technologies, Mflux Motors, Revolt, which are electric vehicle-based companies, got a good push. After that, government offered subsidies for companies who are manufacturing components related to electric vehicles. So now you see the manufacturing sector of the country is also at fast pace to meet the electric demands. So now, where is all this power that is required to run the electric vehicles going to come from? Are we going to burn coal and hinder the already exploited air quality of our country? What are we going to do? Well, India is pioneering towards renewable energy. A recent example, in 2018, Adani Solar Power Plant was inaugurated that generates a massive 678 megawatt of energy, and that's the biggest in the entire world. And trust me, this is just the tip of iceberg. Now, moving on to another important part, lithium. We don't have lithium reserves in our country. So where are we going to get lithium from? Bolivia. Bolivia houses 43% of the entire lithium reserves in the entire world. And recently they signed an MOU with our country so that we can tap into their reserves. But is lithium reliable? How long are we going to rely on lithium? And the import costs are going to be heavy. It is going to affect our economy. Well, there's a particular startup in Bengaluru named Log9 Materials, which is working on developing metal air batteries using graphene technology. Now, if this becomes a reality, if this becomes commercialized, what is going to happen is we are going to get batteries that are going to give us a range of 1,000 kilometers. And they tested the first prototype in 2018, so we're not far. Now, moving on to infrastructure, the government laid out 50,000 crore worth tenders for companies. And this garnered interest from China's Ampere Technology Limited and Tesla Batteries. Although the government plans to give a huge chunk of it to Indian Oil and GAIL and such public sectors so that they are not affected by this transition. Now, talking about the customers, you and I, we matter. What is going to happen to us? Electric vehicles are expensive. They cost it around 20 lakh rupees. Well, I say Maruti knows this market well. They plan to release electric Wagner at a price point of 11.5 lakh. And what we are failing to see that NBFCs and the banking sector and the automobile sector kind of run hand in hand. Where there is Bajaj, there is Bajaj Finance. Where there is Ford Finance. So these companies are going to make sure that they roll out with EMI plans that are affordable to us. Well, end of the day, they are in the business of making money, so they will make it affordable to us. So all in all, I want to say that, changes are perceived with some resistance. And there's going to be some resistance. But India is pioneering towards a greener and a cleaner future. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Molly. Sometimes I feel that the world's reaction to climate change is similar to a 40-year-old man's reaction to quitting smoking. He has tried that for ages and has failed miserably. And once in a while, a little girl advises him. He shushes her, ponders over it for about an hour, quits it for a stretch of 10 days, and then resumes on the 11th with 10% extra smoking. The idea of the implementation of electric vehicles to save the environment reminds me of the little girl. And Niti Aayog's big, hairy, audacious goal reminds me of the 40-year-old man. I'm not saying he cannot quit, but if he does that under a false pretense, it will lead to more damage than good. Although I'm here today to speak that India will not be able to achieve its 2030 target of 100% conversion to non-emission vehicles, which, by the way, they themselves corrected days later, saying that probably only 30% of commercial vehicles will be converted. If we do not look into a few failures from the start of the journey itself, then our environment will have to take the burden even more. The cost of a lithium-ion battery itself is 50,000 rupees, which for an average Indian uncle means two two-wheelers. And moreover, we will have to import lithium, just like oil and natural gas, from other countries because India lacks it. And then there are issues of the procedure and the time to get the papers for an electric vehicle, which is about double the time of getting the papers for a normal vehicle, which will deter the average Indian even further. Now, if protecting the environment was in the mind of these people, then India wouldn't have had 14 out of the 20 most polluted cities in the world. Now, you as my audience, would you immediately try riding bicycles to work from tomorrow if I told you it saves the environment? CNG vehicles themselves do not have 50% market penetration by 2030. Delhi's even odd concept is unheard of anymore. The charging infrastructure, especially level 2 charging in the villages, is another point of consideration in terms of service integration. On an average, it takes 6 to 8 hours to charge an electric vehicle. And for a level 3, that is DC charging, the cost and the renewable energy are the factors to look into. India gets most of its electricity, about 60%, from burning coal. So how does that even make sense to convert to burning coal than using oil or natural gas if it leads to more greenhouse emissions? I understand that the youth of India would very well adapt to EVs in the next 10 to 11 years, like it has done with shared mobility. And I also understand that FAME 2 got a 10,000 crore boost from the environment, unlike FAME 1, which was a failure, only got 895 crores. But in a country like ours, where about 60% of the population still thrives in electricity deprived villages, it will be a Herculean task to pull off. Big, hairy, audacious goals have more history of losses than successes. Let's tread this path with as much caution as possible. Thank you.
Good afternoon to one and all. I'm Shantam, speaking against the motion. I remember the words of my favorite author, Simon Sinek. He said once, there are two ways to influence people, and one is to manipulate it, and the other is to inspire it. For this topic, I would like to rather inspire it. Thinking with the end in the mind, the question is, was India ready for transition? Well, we are not ready for transition. India started a decade back in 2008 when TVS Motors launched its first scooty, the Tinged Electric. Success is reality. Success becomes reality when it catches up to your imagination. And when we saw Apple, it started developing, then only it led to innovations. If I remember my strategy classes well, there are two things. One is the willingness to pay, and the other is the ability to pay. But. And I say this but in the strong big letters. The cars was taken as a segment for a rich segment, but then we saw nano. And this price could be a great factor, but happened to see nano, why not hair? The world needed a balanced scorecard. When automakers throughout the world were heavily investing into electric vehicles, India gave a Rambo response. And when I say a Rambo response, the policy is known as FAME, which stands for Faster Adoption and Manufacturing of Hybrid and Electric Vehicles. The policy measures to see greater demand and greater supply, and also for greater sales, boosting 30% of the India's vehicles in the next 10 years till 2030. Are you all aware of the fact of the Tesla's open source patent pledge? In 2014, Elon Musk said that he is going to open source his patent of Tesla, which could be a great opportunity for the vehicle manufacturing sectors all over the world, especially for the Indian automobile. Any change which is going to happen will likely to see some resistance, and those resistance are always welcome. But when there is a problem, there's always lies a great solution. And I said, like nano happened, things are happening. If I tell you that lithium ion battery is a problem of sorts, but I also tell you a solution, have you heard of urban mining? Urban mining is a concept when we take the rare earth metals out of the surface and reuse it. So there is always a recapitalization in this sector. The recent regulatory reforms and tax rebates in electric vehicles will promote and boost sales. If I'm correct, there are already 2 million e-rickshaws already running in India. Ashok Leyland was the pioneer of the electric bus in 2014. The question is not about are we ready for transition. The solution is India is already ready for evolution. And India has already amassed startups like Earth Energy, which prompt from IIT Madras and is revolutionizing and actually inspiring. It's not only inspiring because people not always buy what you sell, people always buy why you sell it. And if I tell about the investments, the Ola Electric Mobility has raised $250 million from SoftBank. So India is already progressing towards it. The transition could be in technology, but when it comes to electric vehicles, it's not about we are ready. We are already experiencing it, and we are experiencing for more than a decade. The primary will always to go for what we want, because I'll go for what I want, and I want to see the Indian Tesla. And I'll close my words with the words of Steve Jobs, to stay hungry and stay foolish. Thank you very much.
Points on the vehicle, but what about the infrastructure?
So sir, about infrastructure, Reliance Energy started about revolutionizing this, and they believe that they can do it, and that's why they have opened 15 charging stations. 15 charging stations across these distribution centers in Mumbai. The another example I can give you about the Indus Towers. Indus Towers are actually putting up the charging stations to their vast network of telecom sectors. So this is related to charging. The second for the development, if I tell you the infrastructure based on the roads, that's up to the government. But if I go into production sector, then actually, if you see Maruti has exchanged technology with Toyota. The Hyundai is already with the car in the picture. The Tesla has given an open opportunity for its using its free patents, and Tesla's charge can be fully charged in 2 hours to 100% and can give up to 999 miles. So these are the points which, keeping in mind, the people are already have started, the business leaders have already started investing into technologies. So based on this, I believe that infrastructure is not starting, it's already growing.
Come to the end of Maria Philip Intercollegiate Debate Competition. I request the judges to head to the MDP room to deliberate over the results of the competition.
Sajna, Anjana. तुमको गजर पागल तूने मुझको है चुना, तुमको गजर पागल तूने मुझको है चुना, ऐसी तूने अन कहा तूने अन कहा सब सुना, तुमको गजर पागल तूने मुझको है चुना, तू दिन सहे मैं रात आना दोनों मिल जाए शामों की तरह, ये मोह मोह के धागे तेरी उंगलियों से पर की झपकते हैं दिल में निकल जाए, बैठी बैठी भागी फिरूं मेरी तरफ आता है गम फिसल जाए, आंखों में तुमको भरूं
I'm
Collegiate, students, ladies and gentlemen. It's actually a very nostalgic moment for me as much as it is for Professor Philip, because other than him, I'm the only one who has met Maria, spent some time with her, being a fellow classmate at the Madras School of Social Work way back 33 years back. So I have fond memories of Maria, She was my junior when I was in the second year, and she was a very bright student like many of you here. She was very talented, multifarious, and had streaks of leadership in her personality. In fact, we worked on a couple of projects, and after I passed out, she continued to be there, and then suddenly in the month of September, I got the news that she passed away due to a freak accident. And I think as much as Professor Philip misses her, I also miss her, and that's one of the reasons why I have a long-standing association with Professor Philip and XIME, and I'm happy to be here. And what a great tribute that the father has made to his daughter by instituting an award which is perpetual in nature, which started off in a small way in Kerala way back 33 years back, and today of course it is a contest which is spreading across three states, Tamil Nadu, Kerala and Karnataka. And even in Karnataka we started about 20 years back. Until last year, it was just restricted to the Bangalore area. But this year, we said that there are a lot of unsung talents in the far-flung areas of Karnataka. Why not we give an opportunity, a platform to identify another Maria, right? That's how we said we will spread across to Mangalore, to Mysore, and then in Bangalore. We had regional rounds. 27 teams participated from among the best colleges of Bangalore, of Mysore and Mangalore. And finally today we presented to you 9 of the best teams. And of course we put forward our own team also to see where we stand among competition. And it's been an exhilarating 3 weeks for me. We saw some of the best speakers, some of the best talents coming across. And speaking on a social cause, which I think is a raging debate in this country. Mobility is a big issue. And there's a big push for electric mobility. And we felt that this topic would be good enough for debate. We didn't restrict ourselves to just the B schools. We opened it to all schools, engineering colleges, B schools, arts and science colleges. We did not restrict to just masters. We also said even graduates could compete and participate. And I think age is no barrier, and experience is no barrier. And you will see as you see the results as coming forward later on today. It's a great pleasure, and I'm very happy to be here, and I wish that this grows bigger and bigger in the years to come. Thank you.
I now request Ms. Vaijayanti MRDC, Chairman of the panel of judges, to give a feedback on the competition.
Chairman Professor Philip, Dr. Alexander, directors of the XIME group of institutions, professors, fellow members of the jury, participants and unwilling audience. It's been a great evening so far, and I've quite, you know, today's probably the 10,000th time my name was mispronounced, and that's probably because my parents never got their spelling right. My name is Vaijayanti. They were smoking something when they named me. I want to ask them. Anyway. It's been a fantastic debate. I've quite enjoyed the company of my jury. I feel very Draupadized. I don't know if you know what Draupadi's situation was. She's always blamed for the war. Right? So I feel very Draupadized, for want of a better word. All these men sitting with me, bullying me, if you will understand what I mean. But that's a nice jury. Fantastic insights for me as a part of their team. A few insights to all of you participants. You know, in a debate, I'd not give my point of view first. I'd like to give a couple of my fellow judges' points of view. They looked largely for policy, ecosystem, tech, consumer, availability of product, originality, adherence, natural delivery. I quite go with what their assessment is. However, you know, from a point of view of somebody who's probably had a few run-ins with some of the best, I don't know if you know Sanjay Pinto, I was telling them. Sanjay Pinto today is a journalist with NDTV. He used to be a fellow debater at Madras University when I was studying, and he used to thrash us in 2 minutes. You know, unlike an oratorical competition where your elaborate content matters, in a debate, a large part of what you do in the first 2 minutes of what you get is what determines where you stand in a debate, right? which means you need to bring yourself into the topic that you're speaking. The judge, the person who's debating with you, needs to know that you have a completely packed, you know, what I would call the economics, the social, the emotional veracity to what you're saying, right? And that's what is important in a debate versus in an oratorical competition. Some of the observations for us here where it was, you know, what is your content veracity? I mean, where are you getting your content from? If you're sitting with the first two links on Google, you've lost the game, right? I mean, Google has Google Scholar. Sometimes context and history comes on the 20th page of Google, and you have to have the patience to research, you know, what you do. Even in creative pursuits, that's very important. Number one. Number two, do not throw data without validity. The judges sitting in front of you are not fools. Just like you prepare for your debate, the judges read up on the content. Some of them are subject matter experts. So please do not, you know, throw unvalidated data. Number three, take your time. In a debate, it's quality versus quantity. You don't have to rush in everything. It's not like writing a theory paper. It's about validating and deliberating on what you say and saying it with efficacy and effectiveness. Lastly, I thought some of the people who you will hear eventually who won the prize have won it primarily because they brought originality, correct me if I'm wrong. They brought originality, they brought content, and they stayed on stage, you know, their presence, either through content, through humor, or presence of mind. And that's what takes a debate very well. That's what engages the judges and the audience. It's been an honor and a pleasure and a privilege to be amidst students. You know, this millennial generation, I have a 16-year-old son who's far more painful than y'all. He doesn't even want to listen. So appreciate the patience. Apologies if I may have been abrasive to some of you for talking. I apologize. But thank you for this opportunity and grateful for this evening.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, we would like to introduce our beloved chairman, Professor J. Philip. He is an industry academia veteran for over 5 decades. He was the Dean of XLRI, former Director of IIM Bangalore, and now the Founder and Chairman of XIME. So, I will request you to come and address the gathering.
Vijayanti, thank you for that wonderful public speaking class. I'm glad you invited to come and take a session here for you in public speaking. Lovely, wonderful. You summarized what we take 24 classes to teach them. You did it in 4 minutes. You remember the speech by the provost, and I'll be followed by Dr. Alexander, whom I requested to be the chief guest. We were supposed to have Mr. Surya, the MP of this area, to be the chief guest, but he's still stuck in Vidhan Sabha, so he cannot make it. Dr. Alexander was the one who invited him, so I said, question to be the chief guest, Dr. Alexander, you heard me, so the chief guest. So I'd like to thank him for agreeing to be. Let me first introduce Dr. Alexander. All of you know him as the chairman of XIME Kochi. But you may not know that he has been a towering pillar for us, for me, all these years, almost 25 years, he has been an ardent, continuing, very committed supporter to XIME in many, many ways. He started his career as a lecturer at a college, an English lecturer. So you're going to listen to his speech, it'll be wonderful. At Fatima Mother National College, Kollam now. And then from there he joined the IAS, grew up to become the Chief Secretary. he was so popular, the political power was pulled him into politics, and he became an MLA and a minister. He was tourism minister, I don't remember who it was. Whose time was that? Some of the chief minister? Who was the chief minister in your time? Asam Krishna was the chief minister. They had fantastic relationship. In addition, he has a number of other interests. For example, he was the chairman of the YMCA of India. And currently, he is the global president of the Global Federation of Warehousing and Logistics Association. So, various kinds of things. And above all, on this occasion, a great, great speaker, so you will be listening to him. Now, coming to the veteran group, or veteran group of judges, we had a fantastic. Thank you, Ranjan, for bringing such a fantastic group. And lady has been marvelous, beautiful and marvelous. So good to have you. You made up for all the four, all by oneself. Great. So we had a fantastic. So we have a fantastic group of judges, and you have one of them speaking. Only because the time of the resident have made all five of them to speak. Thank you, judges, for joining us. This is a great family event for us here. As Ranjan and Prabhu said, this is now family events at all three places. Kochi was over, we were there last Friday. Yeah, just a week ago. In Kochi, it's so popular, there are 77 teams who participated. And they couldn't contain it in three centers. It used to be only three cities. So this time that has spread it to six cities. Starting with Trivandrum and ending with Calicut. Very popular, it's increasing, growing in great popularity. And this is the first time, as Anjan said, that we also spread out here. Until last year it was only here. But this year we said, following the footsteps of Kerala, that we would also do it in Mangalore, Mysore, and then Bangalore. The same is being followed in Tamil Nadu, where the finals are on 24th of this month. I'm so happy that this is something which he always loved. He was a great, passionate speaker, which said about, remember this, NKD reading out, we shifted from Delhi 85, and 84 was this montage about which this young lady referred to. And montage was a big function at Jesus College. She was not a president, I think she was an organizer. So at the end of that, they had a vote as to who was the most popular girl among all those who assembled from all over the country. That is where she said she was elected as the most popular girl. So she is very, not only a speaker, but very, very good with people. But then as Prabhu said, God seems to have a way of picking up the right ones. So we lost it, but then he gained it. But she was, as she said, the inspiration behind, you know it. So in Kochi, when I was speaking, I said, if there is a founder or a foundress for this place, it is she. But for her accidental, untimely freak, accidental death, there would have been no sign. I would have been somewhere else. But then he has certain ways, and this is what has happened. I want to thank you, the students, for organizing so beautifully, and also being such, my hope is to make this the best. It's difficult to go to North India, so we'll confine it to South, the four states, Andhra, Telangana, maybe five states, and make it the very, very, very best. The big competition, so people should be able to say, it's a debate, it is XIME. And we are starting another thing this year, as you would know. Professor Suryanarayan is on that. He is a national competition on business plans that is coming on 27th of November. So that would have local competitions like the speaking. And then finally, the best ones have been brought here to pick up the best business plan of the country. And we will have venture capitalists like the young man sitting there. Where are you? Yes, like Mr. Narayan, we hope to have four or five of them. If you haven't seen, I only saw it this time when I went to America, there is a feature called the Shark Tank. If you have not seen it, see it. Shark Tank, where CNBC brings out a daily feature where some of these business chaps come and present their proposals, and venture capitalists sit there and grill them. Ultimately, one of them say, yes, I'll take it, I'll support you, kind. So that's the kind of thing we envisage to happen when we come to this competition, the business plan competition. Again, something it will continue with for years to come, and the prices, they said, are pretty good. The top prize is, now, first prize is 2 lakhs rupees for that contest, and second one is 1 lakh. Okay. The contestants who came from 12 colleges, one did all for 2 people, is it?
One.
Yeah, so he did for both. Oh, he did for one. All right. Okay. So we had 11 and a half teams, which did quite well. I was very happy. I remember 33 years ago, October 1, 87, when we had the first competition at Assumption College, Changanacheri. That I had to be where my wife studied. So that's where we started. Maria did not study there. She always studied in the north, Ranchi and Delhi. And then came to Madras. Yes, that's where we started 33 years ago. I look at the standard, the way that the standard grew all these years, fantastic. Just see it and say, okay, 33 years, the kind of changes that happened in the speaking and the mastery of English by our people. Very good. Excellent to see that. I was so happy. Right, and with that, you contestants, thank you for coming. We value your presence, we love you, and we wish you good future in your time. And the front meal, Professor Ranjan, he came and when he joined, he said, I will handle Maria's debate. So I forgot that connection. Then he said, don't you remember that I was a senior? So to the senior of Maria, my very special thanks. You did it so well. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. J. Alexander, Chairman XIME Kochi, to address the gathering.
While listening to the speeches, I heard someone saying, wonderful good evening. Another person saying, happy good evening. I'm just saying, simple good afternoon. This, why I said about happy good evening and wonderful good evening is, some years ago, when I was in the Mysore University as a registrar, we had a great educationist as the vice chancellor, Dr. Sriman, and we had a professor, I remember his name, Professor K.B.Y. Totappa. He was the professor of political science. He had a habit of using the word please in place and out of place. Every sentence you begin with a please and end with a please. Yes, please, no, please, sit down, please, get up, please. And Dr. Sriman was a great educationist. This was when we were all there in the meeting. Professor Totappa walked in and he said, good evening, please. And immediately the vice chancellor said, good evening. but why that please? So I wanted to ask those why. Why that happy good evening? Why that wonderful? No, this is really light. Those of you, the be all and end all of XIME, the person who is the cause for the existence of this institution, all the distinguished judges, our very eminent Professor Anandaraman, and Professor Ramesh Ranjan, who claimed that he is the only one who knew Maritri. He did not remember that Professor Philip was sitting there. Anyway, dear friends, for I don't want to make a formal speech because you have been hearing speeches for the last 3 hours. For us and for Philip, for Professor Philip and for all those of us who are associated with him, the Maria Philip Memorial debate is not just a debate, it is an emotional issue. We also share with him the beautiful memory of the girl who inspired him to start this thing. She was herself a great debater. We have in Malayalam a part of a poem, Ormagal Marikimo, Olangal Nilakimo. You know the meaning of that? Will memories ever die? Will the waves of ocean ever cease? Ormagal Marikimo, Olangal Nilakimo. Ormagal Marikimo, Olangal Nilakimo. There's a beautiful song. So the memories of loved ones, just as the waves of the ocean never cease, memories of loved ones never die. And the memory of our beloved Maria Philip will live as long as XIME lives. Professor Philip, thank you for perpetuating the memory through this beautiful program. We have been conducting this program for the last 33 years. Now, in Cochin and Chennai also we have started. This program has been open to so many students. In Cochin, the other day, we had a function. 77 students participated from various parts of Kerala. And similarly, in Karnataka also, 23 students have participated. We would like to have this participation by more and more students in the future. The idea of this is one is to perpetuate the memory of Maria Philip, who was herself a debater. The second thing is to emphasize the need for the students who come out of our education institutions to have the capacity to face an audience with confidence and articulate whatever they feel, whatever thoughts they have. I always quote a very great sentence of an English author, Francis Bacon. I'm very fond of quoting that whenever I address students. He said, reading makes a full man, a rounded personality. Writing an exact man. Writing makes for precision. And conference or debate makes a ready man. Nowadays, the reading habit is now coming down. Instead of reading, we only download. And instead of writing, we will text. And instead of debate, we chat. All those things have gone. But still, the value of reading can never be replaced by downloading in a computer. There is a famous author who said, when you read a book, you come into contact with the precious lifeblood of an author. That experience you don't get in the computer. You get into direct contact with the precious lifeblood. You can smell the breath of the author when you read. So the reading habit must be increased. Nowadays the reading habit is coming down. When we have interviews of students for admissions or any other purposes, the habit of reading newspapers is now almost gone. People don't read newspapers. I remember holding an interview for a medical college in UP, and my colleague was a professor of medicine from Sarojini Naidu Medical College in UP. So the candidate who came was a student who studied for 7 years in their college, MBBS and the postgraduate, including the time spent for failure and passing. He spent 7 years in the college. As you entered the medical college, there was a huge statue of Sarojini Naidu, whose memory is associated with the freedom struggle and all. He was there for 7 years, passing through that statue every day. And after 10 years of his practice as a medical graduate, medical practitioner, he was facing an interview. And this professor, who was also a student, asked him, "Oh, you are from Sarojini Naidu College?" "My college." "Who are Sarojini Naidu?" "Sarojini Naidu." "Mrs. Naidu." "You must be Mrs. Naidu." Now, what I mentioned is, we have so many examples like this where people don't know something which are very, very, very close. So you must always keep your eyes and ears alert to whatever is happening around. You must have the leadership qualities. Now, when you come for a debate, the judges, on behalf of the judges, Jayanti has already mentioned. I don't want to make any comments on that. But you know, what is required is not reading out statistics. What is required is that you have to face the audience and see their reaction and talk to them. The preparation for that is not merely getting out statistics. You should try to get information about the great speeches in the world, speakers who have been able to move history. You know about Mark Antony, who was able to train a whole crowd of people who were supporters and brutus against him. If there is an opportunity, read the speech. I recently had a live picture of Swami Vivekananda. It is now in circulation. Vivekananda addressing the 1893 Chicago Conference of World Religions. It is now coming out. I was quite impressed by that. In fact, I have read about his speech. I have spoken about that on many occasions, but seeing him in a picture was such a thrilling experience. The person, when he was invited in 1893 to the World Conference of Religions in Chicago, many of the great professors of theology and science were astonished that a Swamiji, a fakir from India, the land of elephants and magicians, could be invited for that. He came and stood. I mean, if I would recommend to you that you must not try to get that. He came and stood before the big audience, looked at all of them, and said, "Sisters and brothers of America," started that, and for 5 minutes there was an applause. For seeing the way he spoke, sisters and addressing the people, and for the first time, they gave priority to sisters. All along they were saying brothers and sisters. For the first time, Swami Vivekananda addressed the sisters and brothers in America. And he mentioned about Indian culture, the Vedanta's greatness, and concluded by saying, when he was approached by some journalists, they asked him, "Sir, you are from India. You have changed the perception of all of us about India. I would like to project you, or we would like to project before you, that in 100 years from now, predict before you, 100 years from now, India will be one of the most prosperous, one of the most wealthy countries in the world." They thought Swamiji will be elated. He looked at them with a mischievous smile and said, "My dear friends, I am not interested in my country becoming one of the richest countries in the world. I am not interested in my country becoming one of the most prosperous countries in the world. But I am interested in my country becoming a home where all people will live as brothers and sisters, following the philosophy of Vasudeva Kutumbakam." A speech which has thrilled many people, which has influenced many people down the ages. We all know the speech of Martin Luther King, "I have a dream." Not a long word, but "I have a dream." And that dream has given enthusiasm to so many people. In fact, it is that dream which has made Barack Obama become the President of the United States. I happened to be in the United States on the day Barack Obama was elected. And I remember seeing in the newspaper one statement by an author: "Barack Obama has been elected as President of the United States, where 150 years ago, he would have been sold in the market as a slave." And he said that this is the result of the dream of Martin Luther King. It's the effective speech. Abraham Lincoln, all of you know, said a famous Gettysburg speech. I'm speaking about the value of cultivating the capacity to address gatherings and make speeches which can remain in the minds and hearts of people. Near home, we know that the greatest leader that we have now today, I'm not speaking about politics, but think about the capacity of our Prime Minister Narendra Modi, the way in which he can communicate. The greatest talent that he has is the capacity to communicate. You attack him, he will take that attack into a positive sense. What I'm trying to say is, develop this capacity to articulate. And this articulation must be, for the subject, but you should also have a vision, and you should be able to have the capacity to communicate in a very interesting manner. So participation debates are going to be very, very useful, and it is a very essential part of the program of preparation of our students for leadership. Now, apart from that, I am sure Professor Philip must have had, this is my imagination, he must have had the idea that this subject, behind this subject, there is the idea that there must be awareness on the part of all of us, particularly the youngsters, that we must be concerned about our environment. All these electric cars and saving the energy and things like that ultimately are related to our universal concern for the planet. There is a big campaign all along the way for planting trees. Somebody told me that this tree planting campaign is from the region of life. I counted by saying, I have an experience to tell you. In 1981, I was the Secretary of Government of Karnataka for Social Welfare Department. In the software including tribal welfare. There was a tribal welfare project with the World Bank assistance in Coorg district of Karnataka. There was a group of tribals who opposed the project there, saying that would destroy the trees in that area. They did not want, now we hear about us when I went along with the forest officer, along with the World Bank expert, to visit the village to convince them that what we are proposing to do is in your interest. When we went there, the first hut we saw, there was a very old lady sitting in front of the hut. The American from the World Bank who was with us was very much interested to see this lonely lady sitting in the midst of the forest. So we walked up to her. She gave a smile, very broad smile as all villagers do. And this man whispered to me, "Mr. Alexander, this lady living in this forest area without any of the facilities for comfortable living gives a smile to me which I have not seen in the whole of the United States. I have not been able to smile like this. My children have not been able to smile like this. What's the secret of that? That is the secret of India." But then he went to her and asked him, "Madam, how old are you?" So she turned to me and said, "What is he asking?" He said, "How old are you? What is your age?" "You guess to eyesight." What does that mean? How long have you been here? Guess to eyesight. How many years have you been here? She said, 10 to them. That's a forest officer. He will be able to judge the age of a tree. see the tree in front of my house. Let him go and find out the age of the tree. This forest officer went to the tree, just examined it, came back and said, sir, it must be more than 105 years. Came back and said, and the old lady said, that is my age. On the day I was born, mind you, I think for 1981. 81, that lady says, the year I was born, my father planted the tree. 105 years ago. The tribals of Kuru district knew the value of trees, the value of protecting environment. My dear friends, the message through the subject of this, I would presume, is that along with arguing in for or against electric cars, remember that all of us have a divine duty to protect the environment. Thank you very much.
I now request Dr. R. Sridhar, Director, Bangalore, to hand over the mementos to the judges as a token of love and gratitude.
It's an honor to be able to announce the winners on behalf of my esteemed panel of jury members. We've looked at multiple parameters. We've been told to identify one best speaker and two best teams, team one and team two. However, with the permission of my panel, I'd also like to have to make a special mention for one or two people who individually stood out as a part of their team for authenticity, for originality, for their ability to connect. This is not the prize, but the special mention for the two individuals I'd like to announce. Special mention to Naveen and special mention to Ekta Barman. I think Naveen, you have a lot of guts and you're good fun on stage, right? And Ekta, fantastic, very proud of you, very courageous, like your delivery, your diction. I'm giving you to work on that, right? Thank you, fantastic. I will announce the runner-up team. Is that okay? Yeah? When I announce, I request the team to come up on stage. I also invite Chairman Professor Philip to please give away the award. Somebody else? Am I getting it wrong? Okay. Oh, I just announce it? Okay. I will announce it and then you all can forget about the prizes. The runners up, okay, before the prizes, sorry, oh, there is an order. Sorry, Ramesh. The jury will give away awards to all participants. This is stage fear, right? I'm getting it wrong, but I invite Shivakumar to give away the first set of participant prizes. You don't want to do that either? Guys, all my points, brownie points are gone. Okay, runners up, finals team runners up goes to School of Social Work, Roshni Nilaya Bank, Mangalore, Jason Pinto and Chintana. You know, here I must tell you, Jason, you took the score for the team. Chintana, you can work better. You guys don't need to come on stage at this time. We know who you are. The winner, any guesses on who the team winners could be? Shantam, no. I saw Shantam nicely waving out and giving a nice smile to the audience. No, it's not Shantam and Molly. But yes, they scored very well. As a team, they did very well. Congratulations, Shantam and Molly. Special mention to both of you. You did very well as a team. The winners of the team award are St. Aloysius, Mangalore, Naveen and Vaimon. A very important role in organizational success. As an HR person, I must tell you, individual excellence doesn't matter. Sometimes it's the team that excels, and these two individuals show how teamwork really matters. Well done, both of you. We're not giving you the prizes anymore. Okay, the best speaker, the winner of this finals, any guesses? Which guy? You know what? We thought about Mehul. Lots of guts. Mehul, again, special mention to represent your team individually. You could have done better on content. You did great on delivery. However, the winner of today's competition is Jason Pinto, School of Social Work. For assertion, ability to speak with clarity, ability to put out original points, and he had tough competition from two others whose name really doesn't matter now, but I think assertiveness, presence on stage, and ability to hold his calm and composure while answering the judges, I think that's what got him the award. With that, I hope the judges and the respected guests and panelists here agree to this assessment of ours. And thank you so much for an opportunity, everybody. Appreciate it. Soumya, I invite you to take over the stage, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I would request all the winners to come on the stage to receive their awards. I will start with the Bangalore regional winner, Ms. Nadia Shaleen and Mr. Ben Joseph from IFIM Law College, and I would request Mr. Shivakumar Venkateshwaran to present their own.
Thank you.
winner, Ms. Ekta Parman and Mr. Doram Raju Shubhakar from STIME Mysore.
Best speaker that goes to Mr. On behalf of everyone present here, I thank the Chief Guest, Dr. J. Alexander, Chairman XIME Kochi, for placing the event. And I also thank the judges, Mr. Ashish Kushu, Mr. Shiv Kumar Venkateswaran, Mr. Narayan R. Tamaya, Mr. R. K. Shenoy, and Mr. Swajayanti Marksar, for taking time out from the busy schedule and officiating this event competition. I thank Professor J. Philip, Chairman XIME Bangalore, Professor Anant Raman, Provost XIME Bangalore, and Dr. R. Sridhar, Director XIME Bangalore, and Professor Ramesh Ranjan of XIME Bangalore for providing us with the guidance and support necessary to conduct a successful event. Last but not the least, I would like to thank the audience for being patient and encouraging throughout the event. Thank you.
भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड़ उत्कल बंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तब शुभ नामे जागे तब शुभ आशीष मांगे गाए तब जय